Hello, Phil here from Wings of Pegasus, and welcome to another analysis video. If you enjoy this video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe. On the agenda tonight, we're going back to the mid-1960s. We're going to be taking a look at Otis Rush, and he's going to be playing through I Can't Quit You Baby. So let's get Otis up on screen and see how he gets on.
You down for a while. Well, you know I can't quit you, baby. But I gotta put you down for a while. Yes, you messed up my happy home, baby. Treat my only child. Yes, you know I love you, baby. My love for you I can never hide. Yeah, you know I love you, baby. I could never hide. Yeah, you know I love you, baby. Well, you know you're my desire. When you hear me moaning and groaning, baby, you know it hurts me deep down inside. Yes, when you hear me moaning and groaning, baby, oh, you know it hurts me deep down inside. Yes, when you hear me holler, baby,
I'm just going to jump in here because the first thing to mention about Otis, not only his guitar playing, but that voice, and especially the way that he starts this track, just belting out a note in chest voice. And Otis's voice right up there in that tenor range, he had such a wide range, but had such control of it as well, the way that he could go dynamically from that belting chest register to then that softer vocal sound as well, and all these little trills that he includes within his vocals as well. Great vocal cord flexibility and the accuracy in order to throw that all together. To then have the ability to play the blues like he does on that fretboard just really means that he's got the top level ability, not only singing, but also playing the guitar. And the main thing to mention about Otis from a technical standpoint with his playing is the fact that he's left-handed, but it is as if he's playing a right-handed guitar because the strings are in the same order that they would be on a right-handed guitar, but he's left-handed. So it means it's all upside down. So when he wants to go for those higher notes, he's not going down the guitar. He's actually coming further up towards himself. And when he gets to that high E string, in terms of the pitch, he's then bending it down with his finger in order to get those bends and pre-bends. So it's just exactly the opposite to how you'd normally string the guitar. And this tends to happen now and again. A few players do string their guitars like this. It's rare, but it's just the way that they've learned to play it generally because they were left-handed and couldn't get a hold of a left-handed guitar, so just took a right-handed guitar and just flipped it over and started learning to play like that. His control of vibrato and slides and bends as well means that somebody watching this who doesn't necessarily play guitar won't see or notice that the strings are in the opposite order because he's learned to play so well with the strings as they are. are. Otis was one of those legendary blues performers who was inspired by guys like Muddy Waters, who you can find on this channel if you want to check out his playing. And Muddy Waters inspired so many future generations just to pick up the guitar and start playing the blues. Otis was one of those. But then also, Otis inspired another generation, such as Eric Clapton, Peter Green, Michael Bloomfield as well. And this cycle of blues players that we had coming out in the 40s and 50s, I say that we had coming out, this was over in the USA. So it meant that by the 60s, when the blues was almost on the way out, the younger generation of white people over here in the UK started to get into these blues players, really took it to heart. And that's where we got the Rolling Stones and The Who and Jeff Beck and all of those players, Eric Clapton, really into the blues and had that British invasion over to the USA again. And this video is a snapshot of the time as well. When we cut to the audience, we can see that it's exclusively white. Unfortunately, it's just the way that it was in the 60s. And even just getting a black artist up on stage was a rarity. So having Otis up on stage here, getting some exposure was great because it means that we can watch it now, but then at the time, he could then inspire other artists and a new generation to then really take that blues on and give it their own sound and express themselves with the blues as well. And this track, I Can't Quit You Baby, was actually released in 1956, so we're talking maybe 10 years before this performance that we're looking at. And unfortunately, in 1959, his record label at the time, which was called Cobra Records, that went bankrupt, and he then moved on in 1960 to Chess Records and continued with them. And he did actually jump around quite a lot with different record labels throughout his career. But we'll get back into the performance and resume talking about him afterwards. And there we we have it. Unfortunately, at the end, we just cut to a shot of the audience for quite a long time rather than looking at Otis. And just looking at Otis with his sweater on and his shirt and his tie, and up on stage, he's sweating buckets. So it must have been an uncomfortable performance from that standpoint, but he puts together a great performance, all of those things considered. Also, from a technical standpoint, the way that Otis just hooks that little finger of his rhythm hand underneath that E string, and that'll be his low E string because everything's opposite here on Otis's guitar. And it has been said that that's how Otis got his sound, by hooking his little finger underneath that E string. I think there's a lot more to it than that. The control of vibrato, the slides, the exaggerated bends as well. Of course, here, totally clean tone in the 50s and the 60s. We didn't yet have loads of overdrive and distortion going on. There's only tiny amounts at this time, so you get a real appreciation of a player's ability on the fretboard because there is nowhere to hide. And an interesting thing about Otis, when he was 37 in 1971, he recorded Right Place, Wrong Time with Capitol Records, but that record label never released that album. So Otis then went back 5 years later and purchased the master of that album, so then he was free to release it himself with another label. And it just so happens that, ironically, that album is seen as one of his best works. Otis released his album called Troubles Troubles in 1978, and towards the end of that decade, he then ceased to play live or record any more studio albums. It wasn't until 10 years later in 1988 that he released his live album, which was called Tops, and that was taken from the San Francisco Blues Festival. From this point onwards, Otis had album releases that went up until 2015, and a lot of those were live albums because he didn't record a studio album from 1998 onwards, but he always kept playing live because there was such demand. And let's put this in perspective, because that last album in 1998, called Any Place I'm Going, would have been made when Otis was 64, and that album got a Grammy. So it just goes to show that Otis still had that top quality studio performance and live performance even at the age of 64. And unfortunately, Otis was one of those artists that was affected by the 2008 Universal fire, where 3 acres of the back lot of Universal went up in flames. And initially they played it down, saying that not a lot had been affected, when in fact a lot of their artists who were signed to Universal lost a lot of their master recordings. So a really unfortunate thing to have happened. I think Chuck Berry was affected by that as well. He lost a lot of his stuff. But Otis Rush, such a legendary player and singer, one of those guys that inspired so many other people to pick up a guitar and start playing the blues. He was inducted into the Blues Hall of Fame in 1984. And in 2015, he made it to number 54 on the top 100 guitarist list in Rolling Stone magazine. And he also got the Lifetime Achievement Award from the Jazz Foundation of America. Fortunately, Otis passed away last year at the age of 84 due to complications from a stroke, but thankfully we still have these videos that we can refer back to see him playing live in his heyday, and also we still have his recordings that we can listen to, which we can be doubly thankful for, regarding that fire that I mentioned earlier. But thank you so much for suggesting this video for me to take a look at, and keep those suggestions coming in the comments below. Let me know what you guys think, and if you like this video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe, and I'll see you guys at the next one. Rock!